A very good evening to everyone. I'm Ghazal Jain, Associate Fund Manager, Alternative Investments, and I welcome you to this exclusive webinar. It's that time of the year again, the final 3 months of the financial year when we rush to save some tax by investing in tax-friendly investment products. But in addition to saving tax, it's important that we choose well in order to optimize returns. And so we have with us today Mr. Saurabh Gupta, Fund Manager Equity, and he will be talking to us about what are equity-linked saving schemes and how they can help you save tax as well as create wealth. Is 2021 the year for equity and ELSS investments? And what gives ELSS funds an edge or an advantage over other tax-saving instruments? We have dedicated time post the presentation for taking live questions. So we encourage you to send across your questions for Saurabh on the chat. For a good listening experience, please ensure you're connected to the device audio. Now, without further ado, I will hand it over to you, Saurabh.
Thank you, Ghazal, and thank you everyone for joining in this session about ELSS. Besides ELSS, definitely we'll be talking about markets and macro. Budget's just been out, markets giving a thumbs up, a good 10-gun salute to the budget. So I'll just give you touch upon a few slides on the budget, how macro is looking. And definitely markets being at all-time high above 50,000. A lot of questions on, I'm sure, would be on the markets, good time to invest, valuations and other things. So I'll try to cover those aspects as well. So we can start talking with budget because most of the questions, I believe a lot of questions in investors' mind is how was the budget? Is the market move in line with how the budget is or it's overreacting? So talking about the budget, to start with, within the budget, what we have seen this time is that finally the finance minister has blinked to the extent that she has agreed that we need to borrow more to boost the economy, right? So as the kind of spending boom happens, the economy is expected to benefit. So just a brief upon how budget is or key numbers of the budget. Fiscal deficit, which is government's expenditure, more expenditure over revenue as a percentage of GDP, which was 4.959% in 1920. 2021, the pandemic year, it will end up at 9.49%. It's a huge jump. And 21-22, it will move back to 6.8. Again, it's much higher than what history suggests for us. So big fiscal expansion. There is an adjustment because government has brought in some food subsidy expenses, which was out of budget preview into here. Even if I adjust to those adjustments, this fiscal expansion is huge. Right? So why is fiscal expansion needed? Just two lines on that. What happens is that if you want to expand economy, it's very similar to expanding a business. You are running a business, you want to grow. There are only two options. You put your own capital or you borrow. As a country, we don't have a lot of savings, so we have to borrow. So borrow from the markets, government will borrow from the markets. Once the government borrows from the market, it has two options. One, it uses that for consumption, gives more money in the people's hand, and people use it for consumption through taxes or cash dole outs. Or it says that, no, I will invest in infrastructure, I will bring in assets, create assets, but eventually will give employment and give boost to the economy. It's a longer road. The government has chosen latter. You can see in the capital expenditure, which was 1.65 of the GDP, has moved to 2.25 this year and will move further to closer to 2.6% in 21-22. So government's pathway is, the government wants to go via capital expenditure and not consumption, which was an easier and faster way of recovery. But government being government thinks that the capital expenditure is a better way. Our personal thought was a boost on consumption would have led to higher consumption, higher capacity utilization on the private sector side, and then a capacity expansion by private sector. That would be a much faster roadway, nevertheless. So as I told, 6.8% of GDP is the deficit, a huge number. The bond market was pretty nervous. Equity markets were very happy. They said the spending will happen. There will be infra spending, infra companies will benefit, and there'll be a multiplier effect on cement companies, banks, and a lot of these. Good part, besides the normal infra, government is now very serious about health infra, and we saw large gaps on health infra because of this pandemic, and government has kind of planning to spend more than 136% jump on its health infrastructure spending. So that's a very good news. there were some sector specific announcements where more FDI was allowed in insurance sector from 49 to 74 from 49%. So more FIs or FDIs, people who foreigners who want to invest in insurance have come. That can help in better realization in insurance companies. Some scrappage policies for auto, which respective sectors will benefit. On rural, this time has no major changes in allocation, and rural economy has been doing well. I think that is the reason government now wants to focus on urban and infra more, because last year they spent a lot of money, more than 1 trillion money was spent specifically on MNREGA, the rural job employment scheme. That amount will come down to about 730 billion. So focus is more on urban and infra this time to balance things out. Disinvestment target of 1.7 trillion rupees is a huge target. And if that does not come out, because a lot of this funding besides borrowing is expected to come from this disinvestment. And if government's plan to sell out these assets do not play out, and historically it has not, then this borrowing could be larger and there will be more pressure on bond market and it could be inflationary. So the risk, I will talk about risks also by borrowing if you want to grow, what are the risks later. Meanwhile, we'll move to a slide which shows GDP growth and which shows why we needed this kind of borrowing and what happened in last kind of couple of years and this pandemic year. GDP started to slow down in last 3-4 years, demonetization, GST implementation and other things were and then ILNFS crisis happened, which tightened the bond markets. So GDP was already slowing before pandemic, and then the lockdown happened. And because of that lockdown, you saw that GDP sliding to -23%. It's never heard of contraction. Recovered sharply, showing the inherent strength of Indian economy. As opening up happened, it moved to -7.5, and hopefully this quarter it should again move to positive territory. But still there are damages. And to control those damages, that kind of borrowing and GDP fiscal expansion was much needed. So coming to kind of the next slide, which is more on how things are right now, how are the fast moving indicators looking now? If you look at from September, till November, most of the indicators, fast moving indicators like cement production, steel production, air cargo, rail freight, all have moved to either pre-COVID or are higher than pre-COVID. This means that we are moving to a expansion mode where GDP is now expanding and no more contracting. That is heartening. Now, sustainability of this is extremely important, right? Until unless this expansion sustains, we'll again be in a rut of low employment, low growth and other things. So hopefully the government's bet on spending more on capital expenditure eventually will play out, and these growth rates and improvements should continue going forward. But yes, it will be with a lag because they did not focus on consumption, but focused more on spending on infra. Because what happens is government will start allocation, it will put out tenders, then the tenders will open, then there will be money that will go out. It's a long process. To raise a fact, government is not necessarily a very efficient allocator of capital. That is also so. We always believe that money in the hands of people are more efficiently used rather than money in the hands of government. But nevertheless, government thought they can do a better job, so they are doing the hard work of moving infrastructure, creating capital expenditure, and other things. Nevertheless, so we'll move to the next slide wherein. We'll talk about how and what will recover India and how we believe that India can sustain this kind of growth rates or improvement, which we have seen pre-COVID era. So if you look at two-wheeler sales, passenger vehicles, refrigerator, these are all representations of consumption in India. I'll just like to highlight what happened between at the start of the slide. 2008 is a year where there was a financial crisis of very similar sorts. And in that year, you can see India was selling closer to 8 million two-wheelers. 9-10, when the recovery happened, the way Indian consumption moved up sharply. Look at 2009 when the two-wheeler consumption was 8.4 million units. Then it quickly moved to 10 and then again quickly moved to 13 million. Because what happens in these type of periods, the cost of money goes down, interest rates go down, governments push a lot of stimulus. And Indians, there is a lot of demand for everything because in most of the categories, per capita consumption is very, very low. So there was a very quick jump, and this is the kind of jump we believe will continue to happen in this kind of business cycle also. In 2020, you can see it was 20 million. 2020 itself was a tough year. 21, it will be a down year, but we believe 21, 22, 22, 23 going ahead, things will improve very rapidly because of low interest rates and hopefully government stimulus on capital expenditure works, people get employment, things would improve rather rapidly. Similar is with the case for passenger vehicles. If you look at CAGR of 17%, last few years have been tough, but again, because of this whole interest rate cycle, things would improve rather quickly. Similar is the case with cement. Cement should be a reasonably good beneficiary of this whole infra spend and focus on lower interest rates, and which is getting reflected in real estate cycle as well. So again, this should revive us back to kind of fastest, to a tag of fastest growing GDP, major economy. And that should help us to move to a longer term trajectory that we have, which we are showing in next slide, that how India over last 30-35 years have grown. Over 30-35 years, India has managed to grow closer to 6.1%, right? So there are, in these 39 years, there has been a pandemic last year, there has been a global financial crisis, there have been government changes, assassination of prime minister and other things, but India has somehow managed 6.1%. We believe we could move there back. So 22 will be a sharp improvement year, because what happens is 21 is a low base year where GDP contracted. 22, because of lower base, we will grow double digits in real terms, and then we'll move back to 5.5. But if the government stimulus gets into right place, we could see an improvement from 5.5 to closer to 6.5% on GDP growth rate. So that is how we believe the macro should play out in next 2 to 3 years. Now, how does it reflect into the market? Sorry, I missed out on the COVID thing. So COVID again. Now, most people are not talking about, and while we were preparing this presentation, I believe that this slide has also moved. Earlier, the first slide used to be COVID. Now it moves closer to the 10th slide, which reflects that as of now, the situation is much, much comfortable. So if you look at daily new infections, which were closer to 80,000 in September, it's now closer to 10,000. So that is really helping, and most of the economies in the Western world have seen resurgences and very, very sharp second and third wave. India thankfully has managed to contain right now, it looks like we have managed to contain in the first wave itself. The damage is not that great. And despite high movability, the infection rates are not increasing, and now vaccine is there. So government has approved 2 vaccines and their vaccinations have started, plans to target about 30 crore people by August. But seems like because the infection rates have fallen, people are getting a little kind of cozy and careless about getting vaccinations, and not many people are turning up. Even if their chance is there, the healthcare workers, they're not turning up to get the vaccination, which we believe is important. But as of now, the COVID situation looks much, much comfortable. Coming to the risk that we see on the micro recovery, clearly COVID second wave is a big risk, and that we have seen in Europe. It's just decimating the European economy. That can result in job losses. Again, with kind of borrowing program that the government is running and the fiscal expansion, rising inflation is real risk. And it could impact the consumer discretionary spend. Real stress in the banking sector. Now, government has also announced a bad bank. But we really don't know how the execution will be, and because government has said that they will not capitalize that, I'm not sure how this bad bank will work. And unless that is going to work, we're still in a kind of worry zone. Plus, what is happening is that there is a Supreme Court mandated moratorium which is still running, and we still don't know what is the extent of bad loans in the system. While banks are giving pro forma NPAs, but the clear picture about who is paying and who is not paying will come out only once that Supreme Court order goes away. And as I said, fiscal policy in the expansion mode, inflation is the real worry that we should worry about, because then the benefit of lower interest rate goes away. inflation takes away a lot of your savings, and people really get worried about inflation, and and people generally their ability to consume also goes down because their real income falls. So this is a real worry, we believe, and that has been increased after this expansionary budget that the government has announced. Moving to how markets look, markets are looking what a rally markets have had, and they are looking expensive, no two thoughts about it. But then again, if you look at the P multiple chart, the sharp surge that you see in the end, that has to be adjusted for one change. So this is a current P multiple, current year P multiple. But in this current year, there was one quarter where companies were shut for a large period of time. That was a quarter one. So the earnings are suppressed. So one has to adjust for that one quarter of earning which was not available, and then look at P multiples. Nevertheless, even if we adjust for that, the markets, at least the Sensex, look expensive. But then we have a lot of foreign flows coming in, and we see that the recovery is taking place. And I will talk about that, those things, that how recovery is taking place, how corporate earnings are moving in the next slide, that how we believe that these. So any P multiple can come down by two ways, right? One, market corrects. Second, the earnings goes up. Right. So we believe that there is a reasonable good possibility with the macroeconomic recovery happening, the earning upgrades could happen, which has been kind of absent for last couple of years, maybe more than 3 years. We have not seen a lot of earning upgrades, and markets have been going up purely because on the basis of flows. Now, what we did was we pooled some data of BSE 100 companies and how they have performed vis-a-vis the estimates over the last three quarters. Now, we don't try to focus too much on quarterly earnings, but if you look at last three quarters, this is how the data looks, and I will explain that data. So every quarter, sell side, which is the broking houses, come out with their expectations for that quarter's number. And if you look at Q1 FY21, that is the second column, 35% of BSE 100 companies, list BSE 100, part of BSE 100 index, managed to beat the expectations. Only 35%, 65% did not beat that expectation. But at the EBITDA level, which is the profitability, so one is revenue, then you reduce the operating cost, then you arrive at EBITDA. 48% of these companies managed to beat expectation. This clearly indicates that cost flexibility in the Indian companies are much higher. They will manage to reduce cost much better. Come to Q2, which is the third column, you see 56% of the companies managed to give a positive surprise on the revenue, better than Q1. But on EBITDA level, that increased to 64%. So 64% performed better on terms of cost controls vis-a-vis what the market expectation was. And at the PAT level, because of control on finance costs and other things, that 70% of all the BSE 100 companies, so out of 100 companies, 70 companies performed better than expected in PAT. So there was earning upgrade. Similar is the story of Q3. Till now, all the companies have not reported, but whichever companies have reported, revenue beat is not high. No, people are not companies are not surprising on the revenues, but companies are surprising on the EBITDA level, on the cost structure. Now, what happens is that unless from here on you could control cost because you were not traveling, you could control salary cost, not giving hikes, firing people and the things. Now, as the economy normalizes, unless this revenue picking up happens, it is very difficult to sustain that kind of earning upgrades. So very, very important from here on that the revenue kicker starts to come in, demand rises, and the earning upgrades happen purely from a revenue perspective. From a longer perspective, 3-5 years perspective, you can see what is happening in the next slide. Over last 5 years, earnings have only been downgraded from earlier expectations. Now, if you look at right from FY14, where earning market had a lot of kind of expectations from the regime, the new political regime that was coming up in center, every year earning expectations have declined. So in FY16, the expectation was about in 2014, people were expecting that FY16 earnings would be, this is Sensex earning would be closer to 1800. We ended up closer to 1400. And that's been the story all through. in 2021, again, because of the COVID, there was a sharp reduction. In April, people the sell side cut their expectation. But if you look at absolute fag under the chart on the right hand side, you can see all the three charts for 21 earnings, 22 earnings, and 23 earnings. After that sharp cut, have actually started to move up. So as I was explaining in the previous slide, that the earning upgrades have happened purely driven by cost controls. And now from here on, if that cost control remains and the demand also recovers, we could see further earning upgrades. So everybody gives an example of how the rally was between 2003 and 2007. There the rally was primarily driven by earning upgrades. So this chart should look inverse. Every year, the earnings should go up much better than what people are expecting. And based upon that, your PE multiple should look cheaper and stock should move up. So that is the normal trajectory of a sustainable bull run. Hopefully with government spending happening, lower interest rates, that cycle should begin for Indian equity markets. Now, so that's how the equity markets are looking. We could move to a bit more on our quantum tax saving product, which is an ELSS product. And I'll talk about what to look in an ELSS product while you are investing next 1 or 2 months. It's extremely important that you invest in a good ELSS. Ideally, you shouldn't have waited till Feb and March. And we always tell that the risk is that you might get stuck in a very high market when you try to wait till Feb, March. The best way to invest in ELSS is start early, start in April with an SIP so that you can get an average kind of NAV. If you had done this year, it could have been wonderful. But if you have waited now, this is the time you have to invest, and you have to invest in a lump sum when the markets are kind of high. So it is always better to distribute and stagger your investments and not wait for Feb, March, because market might be a little expensive in these times, as is the case right now. Now, what to look for an ELSS scheme? So in an ELSS scheme, few things are extremely important. One is it has a lock-in, right? So you have to be sure that you invest into an ELSS scheme where there is a stability in the in the investment team, because what happens is once you put in money, you cannot come out for 3 years. And in the meantime, if the kind of fund manager changes, then it will be very, very difficult for you, because a lot of fund management or AMCs do not have a good succession planning mechanism. And if the philosophy changes, you will not get what you have invested for. So one has to be very careful on that aspect. Secondly, you have to be very careful in looking at the churn ratios. Now, the reason you have a lock-in in ELSS is that government wants you to invest into those ELSS, which in turn invest in companies from a longer term perspective. Now, you are investing for long term because you have a 3-year lock-in, but your fund manager invests for trading. Now that you can figure out through the churn ratios. So that churn ratios has to be low, right? So that is the reason that your philosophy, your thinking of investment and the fund manager's philosophy and thinking is matching. So that it becomes extremely important. Third important point is definitely the expense ratios. So you should look at expense ratios as well, very, very carefully. And definitely it should have a good portfolio of mid and small caps. Now moving to quantum tax saving fund, the ELSS scheme, we follow a value strategy, and it's very similar to quantum long-term equity value fund, very, very similar portfolios. We invest in mid cap and large caps. We don't have a cap bias, but we have a liquidity bias, which I'll talk about in the process very quickly in coming slides. Portfolio, as I said, is very similar to QLTF. As is the case with other equity linked saving schemes, it has a 3-year lock-in, but it is one of the lowest in other tax saving instruments. So when you invest in a tax saving instrument under 80C, you get benefits, right? But if you compare to any other benefit that you get from an investment perspective, I'm not talking about tuition fees or talking about repayments of real estate loans and other things. If you compare it with an NSC, you compare it with a PPF, you compare it with any other kind of tax saving product, ELSS has the lowest lock-in. So within 3 years, you can get your money back. Ideally, you should keep it for more than 3 years, but this is one thing that is very, very important and compare it with other products. A 3-year lock-in ensures a discipline, right? Most of us get excited when the fund is or NAV is up 10% or it's down minus 5%, we get nervous and people tend to sell and churn. Now, we always believe that equity is an asset class from a more than 3 years perspective. So this will ensure that you have a discipline for the long term, because near term it's very speculative. It can be very, very volatile, but over the 3 years, the stocks and the companies move towards fair value and you can generate returns. So it is a good discipline that brings it, that is brought in by ELSS. Being an ELSS scheme, it comes with the advantage of building wealth and saving tax combined together, a perfect combination for long-term investing. And it's very, very well suited for child education, retirement planning, long-term investing in equities, plus a tax benefit. So these are some of the advantages that you have when you invest in ELSS scheme. Now I'll talk about more about how we manage quantum long-term equity value and quantum tax saving fund in a very similar style. We manage the fund through a value style. Now there are multiple styles in the market. One is growth style, which is tend to be a little more risky, value, wherein capital preservation is more important. So how we go about it is that we evaluate business. So our team, we have a large team of 8 analysts and 4 portfolio managers. Among them, there are sectors which are distributed. We try to analyze, being bottom-up research guys, we try to analyze the business of the company, the environment, the sector which it operates. Very important is the management and their long-term goals. And whatever their management long-term goals are, can it be sustained through their financials or they plan to borrow? That becomes extremely important. Once the analysis happens, we look at the company's stock price from a relative peer perspective, its history, its market cap and other things. Then we value the company based on PER, which is the price to earning or price to cash flows, whichever we believe is relevant to value that company. Once the valuation is done and there is a research meeting where we discuss each and every company every 6 months, we have a 5-year history and 5-year projection. And based upon that, we arrive at a buy, which is generally 40% lower than a long-term fair value. Now that 40% discount, which we ideally would like to have, that the reason for this is margin of safety. Now, margin of safety is, for example, we arrive at a value of 100 rupees for a stock. And if I go and buy it at 100 rupees, there are risk in the sense that whenever I value, intrinsic value of a stock lies in future cash flows. Now I could go wrong in my assumptions of management, business, and the external environment could change. So to take care of that risk, we always try to build a margin of safety and try to buy below that fair value and hold on for at least 2 years. Sell is generally when the current price is higher than our sell price. We try to sell the company at a fair value or closer to 10% to the above the fair value. And we generally kind of upsides, we want to buy stocks for closer to 45 to 50% with a 2 years perspective. So we'll sell if the CMP is higher than our fair value or the long-term value of the company, if there are better alternatives available, or there is something that has changed in the business, either the management has changed or our view of the management has changed or balance sheet has worsened. Those are the factors we'll try to look when we'll try to exit the company. So that is how it is. We, as I told you, we are bottom-up research people. So we look at companies, not too much focus on macro. So macro is something which is less important to us, but we cannot ignore it, because what happens is, as I told you, the companies don't operate in a vacuum. Companies operate in an external environment, and to have a common band of that external environment, it's extremely important that we take 4 macro inputs from a macro team or the fixed income team. These 4 inputs are GDP, long-term growth rate, inflation, 10-year bond, and FX rate. And there is a key reason why we take these assumptions, because we want every sector analyst to look things with the same prism or same set of data. Now, it should not happen that a cement analyst looking India from a GDP growth rate of 8%, whereas the logistics person is looking at from a perspective of 3%, because there has to be a commonality between how different sectors are looking from the market where it operates. So our GDP long-term expectation is 5.5 to 6. This could move up if the kind of fiscal measures that the government is taking, if executed well, this could move up by a 0.5 to kind of 1%. So that we'll keep a close watch over there. Further, if there is a lot of flows, then also this could move up if we receive a lot of liquidity from foreign portfolio investors, this GDP growth rate could move up because foreign savings come up can be used to ramp up our GDP growth rates, as it happened in 2003 to 2007. Inflation, again, our CPI, which is the consumer inflation, we're expecting 4 to 5%. 10-year bond closer to 6.5, 7. It's closer to 6.1 now, but with the great fiscal borrowing plan that the government has announced, we expect it to move up. And forex rate should be moving between ±2% in a band of 75 to 80, because there are two tectonic plates which are kind of fighting the FX battle. One is the current account deficit, other is the capital flows. So whichever is stronger, the rupee moves in that direction. Generally, RBI does not control the level of rupee, but it generally smoothens out the impact. We have a good forex balance as well. So we believe it should be closer to ±2% in the band of 75 to 80%. So these are our macro assumptions. And based upon these assumptions, as I'll explain in next slide, that how we move to create a portfolio. So we have closer to 4,000 stocks which are listed in India. And we have a first filter of minimum liquidity of $1 million. Once we use that filter, the number of stocks come down to closer to 450 stocks. We look at liquidity because we believe that we should offer a realizable NAV to the investors, and getting stuck in illiquid stocks could impact while the redemption happens and we try to sell the stocks, their value could go down. So that is the reason why I look at a certain minimum liquidity criteria. So 450 stocks, then we filter out the bad companies, the bad management, the bad businesses and companies which do not meet. And we end up with 200 to 220 companies. This would reflect things like domestic consumption, exports and infrastructure. And based upon what companies, where we find value in companies, we create a portfolio of 25 to 40 stocks with a perspective of at least 2 years. Now, a lot of companies are there for longer term perspective, because what happens is earnings rollover happen. And if the company is still trading at reasonably and offer reasonable upside, we continue to hold. So our churn ratios are closer to 20%. So our average holding period is closer to 5 years in the fund. Now, quickly, I'll just try to explain how the portfolio process works in the next slide. How it works is that, as I told you, does the active volume is more than closer to 7 crores? If it is no, it goes back to research team because it is not part of the universe. Is it part of BSE 30 index or any other index for that matter? It does not affect our decision. As I explained earlier, is it below buy limit? If it is no, I will wait till the stock comes into buy limit. If it is yes, which sector does not matter. The portfolio will be positioned where we find value and catalyst. We will not buy companies only because it's value, because it can be a value trap. It has to play. There has to be a catalyst which plays out in next 1-1.5 years so that I can realize that value. And portfolio of 25-40 stocks get created. Minimum weight in any company is 2%, because we want to be a little more skin in the game. Maximum weight is 6% at cost, and maximum weight at market value can go up to closer to 10%. Weights assigned to these companies between 2% and 6% cost is 4 factors: good business, good balance sheet, and kind of stability of earnings where business can compound for longer term. These kind of, these filters are taken care of, the stock will be closer to 6% at cost. Some good high quality companies can go up to 6%. Otherwise, it will be closer to 3 to 4% at cost. And definitely the upside potential is important. If some stock with good high quality management is offering good upside, the weights would be higher over there. And alternatives and cash, I want to switch some at some better name, or I believe that cash is better, then alternatives would also get importance as the markets go by. So that's on the portfolio construction process. Our current portfolio position looks exciting. The portfolio allocation is towards cement, steel, a reasonable position in power and capital goods. We believe will be beneficiaries of recovery cycle as envisaged by the budget, and this could improve because of the kind of fiscal plan the government has announced. And we have not positioned the portfolio because of the budget. This is where the value lied over was last 1-1.5 years, and thankfully with this budget and recovery, our portfolio positions look strong in these sectors which are expected to benefit from this infra boom or capital expenditure boom, which the government has announced. Monsoon has been good for second consecutive years, and some of the portfolio companies are getting benefit out of rural consumption. Tractor name has done well for us. Similarly, to our two-wheeler company, which is focused on rural, has done well for us. We continue to hold them because Rabi sowing has also been good. Now, a good thing happened last year was that because being value managers, we waited for 2 years to get good companies at reasonable valuations. And March was the time when last year markets fell. We managed to get some good market leaders in their respective segments in the portfolio, and they done very well for us. We continue to hold them. We also did a very strong stress test of all the companies in the portfolio, whether they can survive a very bad down cycle, which was expected to play out because of COVID. And most of the companies have very strong balance sheet. One or two who have leverage have very strong parentage. So believe every portfolio companies can survive the test of time and these tough times of pandemic. So we are not worried on that front. We have cash closer to 7%, and we will use these to add new names in case of correction. So that's how the portfolio positioning is. Now, the performance chart looks as it is since inception. The blue line you see is Quantum Tax Saving Fund. We had tough times between 2016 and 2019 because value was out of favor. There was a narrow set of companies doing well, which were expensive, became more expensive. But seems like things have turned around for value managers, and broader market is doing well. There's a broader recovery, and in these environments, value styles tend to do better. So we expect, and the portfolio structure, portfolio positioning is also kind of positioned towards a recovery. So hopefully things should be better from here on. So this is how the chart looks. I'll just take a few minutes of yours on the asset allocation. And while I was presenting on equities and equity linked savings scheme, everybody who is planning their financial goals, a broader picture of asset allocation should not be ignored. And this is one thing we always try to tell to our listeners and our investors, that if you look at last 10-15 years, there are different times when different asset classes do well, right? So look at gold in 2010-2011, it shines really bright. 2008, gold was up 26%, census was down 52%. And similarly, if you look at very recently also, gold did well in 2018. And in even 20 absolute terms, gold has done better. So there will be different times where gold does well, different times where bond does well, and it's very difficult to time. So you have to have a basket of all the asset classes when you are planning your financial goals for the long term. So you should have some gold. You should have some bond depending upon the longevity of your financial goals, and then an equity, a mixed basket as advised by your financial advisor, or you can always talk to our RMs as well. They can give you some sense on this. Is always a great thing. So a diversified basket and a solutions approach of trying to solve your financial goal problem rather than sticking to an asset class is always helpful. Our ideal plan that we suggest to investors, as is highlighted in the next slide, is that to start with, the first thing that you should do with your portfolio, a kind of financial allocation, is that for 18 to 24 months of your annual expenses, monthly expenses, sorry, should be in a safe kind of category. Either it should be a bank FD or maybe a very, very safe liquid fund, which does not take risk, very, very similar to quantum liquid fund. Park your 24 months of savings there, because these are uncertain times as seen by pandemic. There could be job problems, there could be health problems. And at that time, if equity is weak or gold is weak, you will get stuck up and you have to redeem at very bad prices. So good part is that a good idea would be to save closer to 2 years of your monthly expenses into a very, very safe asset. And from after removing that, then you move towards building a long-term asset allocation plan or financial goals plan, wherein closer to 80% should be going into equities for you. And this is a plus 5 year kind of view if you have. And 20%, because gold is insurance to everything. And we do plan a lot of webinars on gold, and Chirag and his team, including my colleague Ghazal, they do a lot of webinars on gold. You should attend one of those to explain you how gold is important from a portfolio approach perspective or asset allocation perspective. from that 80% equity, the best idea would to have an anchor fund of either with a value approach or a long-term approach, where you could park 20% of your allocation. 10% of your allocation could go to the ESG product, which is new style of investing that is emerging. We have an ESG product and we have a few webinars on that as well. It's a very interesting and a fresh, refreshing thought process of looking at things, not only at financials, but how companies behaving on an environment or social perspective. So that should be closer to 10%, and rest 70%, a basket of equity styles that you can buy, either a mid caps, try to avoid small caps, mid caps, growth style, and other managers. And if you cannot choose on yourself, you can choose quantum fund of fund for that 70% allocation. That essentially completes the allocation for you. People who don't have much understanding, that will complete your allocation of your financial goals. So broadly, this was about it. I think, Ghazal, we can open up for questions if the investors have.
Thank you, sir, for taking us through the presentation. And just before we get started with the Q&A, I quickly want to introduce the SMILE facility to all of our investors. It is an initiative between Quantum Mutual Fund and Help Your NGO. So what this facility does, it enables an investor on the basis of his or her consent to contribute some percentage of their investment with Quantum Mutual Fund towards a charitable cause to any NGO that is registered with the Help Your NGO Foundation. To know more about this, please visit our website and check out our FAQs on SMILE or reach out to customer care. Now moving on to the Q&A session. Saurabh, you mentioned that the Quantum Tax Saving Fund and Quantum Long-Term Equity Value Fund portfolios are similar. So our investors want to understand whether the portfolios are identical or is there some difference between the two?
So there could be difference because of different kind of times of care. So there would be periods where there will be minor differences. There are two reasons. One, there is a cash limit of 20% that the fund can go in terms of cash for Quantum Tax Saving Fund, and Quantum Long Term Equity Fund, the cash levels can go up to 35%. So there have been very rare but few instances where cash levels have gone up that high, and that point in time you can see that there are differences on the portfolio. The stocks would be the same. It is just that the weights sometimes differ because of different times of cash accretion and inflows of cash, but that also we try to adjust. So it will be more of a mirror image, but there are times where there could be differences. But the portfolio stocks would be very, very similar.
Thanks, sir. How does investing in ELSS funds help create wealth? Isn't the main advantage a tax benefit?
No, it's a beautiful combination of both of these things. So look at somebody who is investing investing in Quantum Long-Term Equity Value and Quantum Tax Saving Fund. Now, Quantum Long-Term Equity Value will give you an option of redeeming the next day. Quantum Tax Saving does not give you that option, but Quantum Tax Saving gives you a 30% tax relief immediately, right? Plus, you have the same portfolios. Just that you have to wait for 3 years, which any which ways we always tell for even from the Quantum Long-Term Equity Value perspective that whenever you are investing in equities, you should invest with a more than 3 years perspective. So might as well try to take a benefit of tax plus have the same portfolio. That is the reason we try to create this product where people can take benefit of tax plus get a long-term capital gains benefit as well. So that's the reason how this works. So ELSS is a very unique and a good product, as I tell everyone. Lowest lock-in period, as I explained, and a real good combination. And the SEBI does not allow us to give you the calculation, but look at it from this perspective. 1 lakh rupees invested in a tax-saving product. Immediately, your calculation starts. You save 30,000 rupees tax on that because let us assume there is a 30% tax rate. Your CAGR calculation will start from 70,000, will not start from 1 lakh rupees, right? So you already gained 30% for next 3 years. And now whatever you gain from equity accretion or equity capital gains is a bonus that you get, right? So the kind of CAGR that you can get is much superior. So people should look at that benefit and look at ELSS. And you should not redeem after 3 years because that capital accretion will continue, right? So people, what they believe is, okay, 3 years is ending. But even after that mandated 3 years over, keep it allocated towards your longer term goals, and it will give you wonders. that's a, it's a very unique and very nice product, I believe, to have.
So do you recommend investing via SIPs or lump sum for ELSS funds?
Yeah, I always tell that what happens is that if you waited till Jan, Feb, March, look at this year, right? If you had started an SIP or a staggered investment since April, you could have benefited from lower prices in equity markets. From 30,000, the index has moved to 50,000, right? And now if you waited, now any fund, any equity fund you want to buy, any ELSS for that matter, Quantum or anyone else, will reflect that kind of NAV which index is reflecting. So it's always a better idea that the first month of the financial year, you start an SIP, divide whatever your allocation wants to be by 12, and you start investing. That's a much better idea rather than waiting till Feb, March, where you don't know where the markets will be, and your opportunity to buy at lower NAVs is missed out. So better to stagger your investments and better to have an SIP approach rather than a lump sum approach in ELSS as well.
Does this equity market boost post the budget seem sustainable?
Look, so as I told you now, I told that I talked about that earnings upgrade cycle, right? First three quarters, because of cost benefits, there has been an earnings upgrade cycle. Now, for the markets or bull market, if I can call so, to sustain that recovery and that earning upgrade cycle should continue. Right? Every quarter or every 6 months, the company should perform better than expected. And if that happens, the bull market will sustain. Now, government has managed to increase the borrowing of its own kitty, and then it's planned to invest. That will start to play out if it plans to, if executed well, after maybe 6 months, 9 months, when that spending starts to happen. The company's order books start to improve, people start to get employed. Then that will sustain, right? No, we have to see that whether this earning upgrade cycle sustains. We have, over last 4 years, we have had a few false starts where earnings upgraded happened for one or two quarters, but they did not sustain. Market moved where it wanted to move because of flows. But then that is not a very sustainable way of markets moving and making a lot of wealth in markets very confidently. So we'll keep a very close watch on the earnings upgrade cycle. And if that continues, we believe that this is more sustainable than what it appears. Clearly, as of now, market is given too much of a move. We believe that it will not be easy. To be frank, if a consumption-driven boost would have happened, we would have been much more confident that yes, earnings upgrade would happen. But then the money is with the government. How it is spent, whether the timelines are met, because government being government, it has a lot of bureaucracy going around. We'll see how the benefits fall out for the corporate India and how the corporate earnings move.
Sir, can you elaborate on what are the other ATC investment vehicles and why ELSS is a better option?
Yeah, in one of the slides, I explained to you that saving options are many. One, they're categorized in two parts under ATC. One is there are few categories where you spend, but you can kind of take benefits like tuition fees of your kids. You can take a benefit of that. Repayments of real estate, you can take benefits of that. And there are few others. And then you have typical insurance. You have NSE investments, National Savings Certificate kind of investments. You have ELSS. So within insurance and definitely PPF is also there. Now PPF has a fixed interest rate. It has a 5-year lock-in, closer to 7.5%. So that is more of a debt allocation that you have with a higher lock-in. Then on insurance, for the first 3 years, you will not get enough surrender value. You will be at loss to start with. So I'm not too sure about the insurance product as well, because, and we always in financial planning, it's generally suggested that insurance and investment should not be mixed. It's not a great idea. So what you have is ELSS, a combination of tax saving plus, as I explained, an equity exposure for longer term. So I think even if you are thinking that you don't want to invest 100% of your whatever you want to invest for tax saving, some portion should definitely go to ELSS.
Investors want to know whether it's good to redeem your ELSS after 3 years, or does the quantum tax saving fund, for example, show promise for long-term wealth generation?
So as I've explained in our slides and in previous webinars also, equity, whatever the product, whether ELSS or non-ELSS, idea should be plus 3 years of investing. Now what happens is a very famous quote by Warren Buffett is that markets are like voting machine. Whatever majority is thinking will be right. But over the long term, they become weighing machine. They will accurately find value. And if you are a good selector of stocks or fund, that accurate value will play out over longer periods of time. So definitely it's a longer term game. It's, I would ideally suggest it's a more than 3 years game. And whenever you see that, okay, your 3 year tenure is over, my strongest suggestion would be you continue to hold to get the maximum benefit of that compounding that you get out of equities.
Thanks, sir. Regarding asset allocation and planning for an investor's retirement, what equity allocation do you recommend, or is it safer to invest in other less risky assets for someone looking to retire?
So somebody who is retiring and retirement is less than 3 years, ideally a lot of equity exposure is not good. Now it's very important that what is the risk appetite of the gentleman. The intent to take risk and ability to take risk that at that age is very, very important. If you have a good income which continues after your retirement, you have a good pension coming or some good rental income coming, maybe your exposure towards higher equities is justifiable if you have the appetite for that. You've seen that, okay, equity works and you can handle the near-term volatility. But if that saving pool is the only pool that you have for your retirement, it's not a great idea to have a lot of equity exposure. Ideally, as you're getting closer to your retirement, your equity should move to closer to kind of multi-asset products, which are a mix of equity plus debt plus gold. And then eventually, as you're getting closer, it should be closer, move to more safer kind of portfolios. So if that is the only saving that you have, it's not a great idea to have a lot of equities in the portfolio when you're retiring.
Are you going to add a few stocks in QLTF and QTSF in light of the budget and the equity boost? Are there any portfolio changes coming up?
So not because of budget, we are actively looking at different companies, and it's an ongoing approach. We added to few of the existing names over last 3 months, and that has done well for us. As I told, portfolio positioning right now looks to benefit from the economic recovery, and we have cash closer to 7%, and we will look to buy into any good names that we have identified, but we'll wait for a correction maybe. Whenever value emerges, we'll be quick to jump into that opportunity. But we're not trying to play that event. We don't look at equity investment from an event perspective. We look at it from a more perspective of the intrinsic value of the company, its core strength and valuation. So those are the two parameters. And whenever we believe those two things fall in place, we quickly get into buying the stock into the portfolio.
What are your views on small caps, and does QTSF hold any small cap stocks?
We had if I can call it a small cap, there is one stock which is a quite an old stock that we have. I think we have given a long rope to the management, and we are considering exiting that stock. So that would be one stock which was not small cap when we bought it, but it has become small cap. Besides that, I don't think so we would have any small caps, because none of the small caps would come into that filter of $1 million daily trade. And we promise a certain liquidity to our investors. So I don't think so that the portfolio would have any small cap names.
Sure. So are ELSS funds which follow a growth strategy better than those that follow a value strategy?
No, that depends upon how person thinks. As we always tell, you should have a basket of products. You should have a value product. You should have a growth product. So styles are what? So let us assume, as our founder Ajit always tells, your financial goals are your nirvana, right? It's like achieving God. and there are various ways of achieving that God. There are different religions who take you towards your God. Similarly, different styles are also the same. You could go via value, you could go via mix, or you could go via growth. That depends upon person to person. Value style gives a lot more focus to your capital appreciation. And generally, I believe wherever you have a mandate where you cannot pull out money from somewhere, safety is one thing that you should be always be kind of the first thing in your mind. Because once you get in, there is no exit for 3 years. So if it's a growth kind of portfolio that someone has created, and within 3 years, you'll see it go up because you cannot get out of that. It'll go down also. And because it's growth investing, it's higher risky and portfolio could suffer much more losses. With value, you know that they will, it might be possible that initially there is a suboptimal return because market is frothy, but your capital preservation record is much higher. And over the time period, over maybe 3 years, 4 years, that returns will catch up on from the value style as well. So you get a capital appreciation benefit where you cannot take out your money. So it is always look at something where capital preservation is important, because once you get in, you cannot get out for 3 years. So that should be your thought process. It's what I believe.
So we've spoken about the tax benefits of ELSS, but we have a couple of questions still coming on that. With one being, is the return from ELSS completely tax-free? So request you to please elaborate on the tax.
Yes, benefit. No. So in 2018, government has imposed tax long-term capital gains on any equity investments. Up to 1 lakh rupees of capital gains, it is free. Beyond that, it is not free. There will be a 10% capital gains, long-term capital gains tax that you have to pay. Earlier, till this budget, ULIP was offering you something which was tax-free, but now from this year onwards, it's closer to same footing. Anybody having more than 2.5 lakh rupees annual investments in ULIP in a product, they will also have to pay long-term capital gains tax. So yes, you have to pay long-term capital gains tax till 1 lakh rupees, beyond 1 lakh rupees, I'm sorry. So it's taxable, it's not tax-free.
And so finally, with markets having gone up so much, are you considering increasing your cash positions as part of balancing the portfolio?
So cash is always residual to how we are looking at the portfolio. So if the portfolio companies are still giving us upsides, the cash won't increase. If we see that companies are getting closer to sell, the cash levels will increase. So cash creation is not part of the strategy. It's a byproduct. As of now, what we have seen is that over last 3 months, companies have seen good earning upgrades. And that is the reason that the sell prices of the companies have moved up pretty well. So as of now, I don't see cash levels increasing too far until unless market continues to move up very, very rapidly without earning upgrades. So that's how it is. So it's like a combination between recovery versus valuations. Recovery continues and sharper than expected recovery, earning upgrades happen, cash will not get created. But we believe that, okay, now the stocks are moving closer to fair value and recovery is stalling and there is no earning upgrade and there is no upside. We'll start to trim stocks which have moved beyond the sell level, and you'll see cash levels going up.
So with that last question, we have come to the end of the Q&A. Thank you again, Saurabh. I will now request you for your closing comments.
Yeah, so I believe that you should always look beyond two suggestions as part of closing remarks. One is ELSS is a tax saving product, but please, my clear suggestion would be you also think it as an equity product and look beyond 3 years while you're looking at the ELSS products. That is one. And please do stagger your investments. Don't start to look at your tax saving or tax planning in the first week of Jan when your HR sends you a letter that you have to file or your tax related documents. That is not the time to look at these things. You start looking at this from April, plan better, and you'll see benefits coming through for you. That's about it. And thank you for spending some time with us, and hope this webinar was very, very useful to you. Thank you.
Thanks, Saurabh. To our investors, we hope today's webinar has highlighted the dual benefits of ELSS and how Quantum Tax Saving Fund can be a good choice for the same. Though we have tried to cover as many questions as possible, if you still have any queries, please visit our website, www.quantumemc.com, or you can write to us or call our customer care and support team for further information. For those interested, the recording of this webinar will be posted on the official YouTube channel of Quantum Mutual Fund next week. So that's it for now. Thank you all for tuning in. Good night.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.